those of us who are here in this congregation tonight, and probably be a safe guess to say that everyone on the face of this earth has at one time or another wondered where and why this thing we call life comes from. Those of us who are in the beautifully blended body called believers have been given what we know to be the incontestable and irrefutable word of God, where God tells us exactly how this whole thing went down. But when we take our Bible and we present it to those who are outside of the body of Christ, the Bible and the truth thereof is reduced to little more than what some would suggest is a theory. Now, a theory by definition is a supposed hypothesis that's presented by men and women used to explain an occurrence, but it's not necessarily the truth. Now, you're going to need that again, so I'll repeat myself. A theory is a supposed hypothesis that's presented by men and women designed to explain an occurrence, but it's not necessarily the truth. And I know we just got out of school, but all of you have probably heard about some theories all throughout your academic year this year. We've heard of what's called the Big Bang Theory. This theory would suggest that a cosmic accident involving one pile of dust and another pile of dust happening to collide imperfectly and chaotically to burst open into what we call a solar system with the sun and planets rotating and revolving at breakneck speeds but never once bumping into each other. This accident, they would suggest, would put the Earth exactly 93 million miles away from the sun, and if it was 1 mile closer, we would burn up, and if it was 1 mile further away, we would freeze. This accident, they suggest, would allow the Earth to sit precisely on a 23.5 degree axis, which would allow a force called gravity to be so strong that it doesn't pull the birds out of the air, and too strong to keep us walking here flat-footed on the Earth. Y'all ain't saying much. This accident, they would suggest, would allow the Earth, out of billions and billions of planets, to be the only planet that would allow the atmosphere to be conducive for life, which leads me to my next theory, which is called the theory of evolution. They suggest that we as human beings started as four-footed ape-like beings who used to walk around grunting and hunching, only motivated by our need for food and survival. This theory of evolution suggests that we started out as tadpoles, and we evolved from tadpoles to monkeys, and from monkeys to human beings, and developed language and culture and civilization and sophistication out of nowhere. Which leads me to my next theory, which is the theory of natural selection. Y'all ain't saying nothing. You must have been sleeping science class. The theory of natural selection suggests that only the strong would survive, and only the big dogs would get the bones, and the big birds would get the worms, as the nature would mandate for there to be some semblance of governing, which means that this is what they were governed by. So it left those who were a lot stronger or a lot faster, a lot more intelligent, a lot more handsome, a lot more ingenuous, a lot more cunning, a lot quicker, a lot more swift to rule and super rule over those who were less than. The ones who were stronger ruled over those who were weaker. Now, I didn't come to give you a science lesson. I really didn't come to talk about theories, but I got excited when I understood that these theories, especially this theory called natural selection, is by definition what it is, just a supposed hypothesis and not necessarily the truth. Because if natural selection was real, me and about 15 of y'all would have been tore up a whole long time ago. You won't say nothing there, because unlike y'all, I'm not the strongest, and I'm not the fastest, I'm not the most wise or intelligent, I'm not the best preacher, I'm not the best teacher, I don't have the cutest ties or shoes, I don't wear the nicest suspenders, I can't sing. Y'all will catch up in a second. My anointing isn't a superstar Hollywood anointing. They don't shout for me like they shout for other folks. My uncle didn't put a silver spoon in my mouth. I wasn't born on that side of the track. Nothing was laid out for me. But isn't it good news that in the midst of all of my shortcomings and the places where I don't stack up, the places where folks would have counted me out, the places where I'm too weak and I don't have enough, that God has a way to still make sure that I win with the hand I'm dealt. It don't matter if my hair lay down when I
brush it or if it rolled up a few times when the brush hit it. It don't matter if I'm light skinned with hazel eyes or I'm so dark that when I hop out the car, the oil light come on. God's the to make sure that in the midst of what I'm going through, in the midst of what life has given me, he still has a way to make sure that I win. Y'all missed your shout, Cuba. We're going to keep going. It's good news to know that where life would count me out, God still says yes. Where folks would say I'm less than, God still says yes. When folks would say I'm unqualified, God still says yes. Y'all come on. When folks would suggest that because I'm not from this church or from that church, or because I don't carry myself the way they carry themselves, or because I've made mistakes in the past, and maybe because I've made some poor decisions, God still has a way for me to win. With the hand, I'm dealt. We're just getting started. There's another brother, Minister Brown, and I would text, who I'm certain was as equally as excited when he heard that natural selection was just a theory and not necessarily the truth. And his brother's name is Zacchaeus, and we're going to go soon. Zacchaeus, we're introduced to him immediately, and as soon as we're introduced to who Zacchaeus is, we're introduced to the things that he wanted. The Bible says that Zacchaeus just wanted to see Jesus. But as soon as we're introduced to what his desire is, we're introduced to the things that were hindering him from getting to the place that he wanted to get to. Can I take my time and build my case? Yeah. The Bible would suggest that there were three primary things in the text that hindered Zacchaeus from getting to the place that he wanted to be. The first thing was his stature. Verse chapter 3 says that Zacchaeus sought to see who Jesus was, but he could not, for he was of short stature and the crowd was in the way. You know how it is sometimes when you a little dude and you get picked last on the kickball field. Folks treat you like a pet instead of a homeboy. They look down on you and really don't respect you like they ought to. He was hindered by these same issues. I want to suggest this evening though, that even though you may not be exactly like Zacchaeus and being hindered by what's your height physically, there have been some other physical issues that folks would have counted you out on. Maybe they didn't say that you were too short, but maybe they said you were just a little too fat, or just a little too black, maybe a little too male, or a little too female. Maybe you don't have the right color eyes or the right kind of pumps. Maybe your hair texture ain't exactly like they needed to be. But the good news is that regardless of what I'm hindered by physically, God still has a way that if I'm dealt a bad hand by my physical stature, he'll make sure that I win. I'm gonna run, I'm gonna hustle. He was hindered by his stature. The second thing the Bible says that hindered Zacchaeus was the fact that he was a chief tax collector. Now, it's hard for our context to relate to what a tax collector is because there are none that we can see readily today. But I'll bring it home for you. A tax collector in those days was like the brother and sisters who call your house and your mama slap a little bit of black off you for answering the phone. Those are the folks who are writing them letters that sit on the kitchen table that seem not to never get open. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Those are the folks who coming in to get your stuff from you that you work hard for. Gas $5.67 and they still want some more. The tax collectors in that time were even worse because they weren't only taking what was rightfully theirs, but they were taking a little bit extra on the side. Zacchaeus was hindered by his employment because he had a job that put him at direct odds with the people that he couldn't see past. The good news is that just like Zacchaeus had a bad job, his job didn't stop him from getting to the place that he wanted to be. I want to encourage somebody right now who's flipping burgers or sweeping a hotel floor, who might have to be a janitor or don't have the job that you want. It don't matter what you're doing on your employment. The Lord says if I want you to blow up, you gonna blow up, and it ain't nothing that you can do to stop it. The principle is stewardship. So I can be here now with nobody watching me work or be the pastor of the biggest church in the world. The Lord is still gonna bless me. If I'm faithful over a few things, God said that he would make me ruler over many. So even if now I'm working with a McDonald's hat on, God said I'll still make you a millionaire. Even though I'm at Burger King right now, God said I'll still make you a baller. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me in here. Just because you're doing hair now in your kitchen and you got your girlfriends coming over to sit in your living room putting cornrows in, God said I still got a cosmetology degree waiting on you if you keep being faithful.